Let us pray. Lord, would you just open our hearts and minds, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. In your name we pray. Amen. Our church theme, as you know, this year is Sabbath lifestyle. And what it means is not we stop doing everything, but it means that we just pause to review, refocus, and reorientate. And so for our sermon series this first few months, we want to look at the basics of the faith. So we go back to the gospel story. We look at the gospel of Luke. And today the scripture passage we want to look at is from Luke chapter 3. In fact, we are covering the whole of Luke chapter 3, but we want to focus on one passage. And before the service, I actually asked Michael whether he would read the scripture lesson, and he very gamely said yes, but he didn't know what the scripture passage is, so I thought I'll just spare him the torture. I will read the passage for you. The genealogy of Jesus Christ. Now Jesus himself began his ministry at about 30 years of age, being, as it was supposed, the son of Joseph, the son of Heli, the son of Mattath, the son of Levi, the son of Melchi, the son of Janna, the son of Joseph, the son of Mattaniah, the son of Amos, the son of Nahum, the son of Esli, the son of Nagai, the son of Maath, the son of Mattathiah, the son of Simei, the son of Joseph, the son of Judah, the son of Joannes, the son of Reza, the son of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, the son of Neri, the son, now you know what I mean, huh? The son of Melchi, the son of Eddi, the son of Kosem, the son of Elmodam, the son of Ur, the son of Jose, the son of Eliezer, the son of Jorim, the son of Mattath, the son of Levi, the son of Simeon, the son of Judah, the son of Joseph, the son of Jonan, the son of Eliakim, the son of Miliah, the son of Menon, the son of Mattathiah, the son of Nathan, the son of David, the son of Jesse, the son of Obed, the son of Boaz, the son of Salmon, the son of Nashon, the son of Aminadab, the son of Ram, the son of Hezron, the son of Perez, the son of Judah, the son of Jacob, the son of Isaac, the son of Abraham, the son of Terah, the son of Nahor, the son of Serug, the son of Reu, the son of Peleg, the son of Eber, the son of Shelah, the son of Canaan, the son of Arpaksad, the son of Shem, the son of Noah, the son of Lamech, the son of Methuselah, the son of Enoch, the son of Jared, the son of Mahalalel, the son of Canaan, the son of Enosh, the son of Seth, the son of Adam, the son of God. This is the word of the Lord. After reading this, you sort of like, you know, Luke, I am your father. As I was preparing this message, in the office, we used to laugh about this, that I'm preparing the sermon called the Limpe Sermon. We don't usually look at this passage, and I'm going to read another passage which is equally difficult to read, but I want you to compare the names that I've read just now, okay? You just get an idea of the names. This one is the Matthew version of it, the parallel passage in Matthew, okay? It's equally tialat. This is the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, Judah the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar, Perez the father of Hezron, Hezron the father of Ram, Ram the father of Aminadab, Aminadab the father of Nashon, Nashon the father of Salmon, Salmon the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab, Boaz the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth, Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of King David. David was the father of Solomon, whose mother had been Uriah's wife. Solomon, the father of Rehoboam, Rehoboam, the father of Abijah, Abijah, the father of Asa, Asa, the father of Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat, the father of Jehoram, Jehoram, the father of Uzziah, Uzziah, the father of Jotham, Jotham, the father of Ahaz, Ahaz, the father of Hezekiah, Hezekiah, the father of Manasseh, Manasseh, the father of Ammon, Ammon, the father of Josiah, Josiah, the father of Jeconiah and the brothers at the time of the exile to Babylon. After the exile to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Shealtiel, Shealtiel the father of Zerubbabel, Zerubbabel the father of Abiud, Abiud the father of Eliakim, Eliakim the father of Ezor, Ezor the father of Zadok, Zadok the father of Akim, Akim the father of Eliud, Eliud the father of Eliezer, Eliezer the father of Matan, Matthew, the father of Jacob, Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, and Mary was the mother of Jesus, who is called the Messiah. Now, if you look at the list carefully, and if you've got time, I'd like you to just copy the names down and compare the list. You will notice a few things, and a few questions will come to mind. Okay, today's message is a bit academic, but not to worry, at the end we'll move into practicals. If you look at it, it looks like two different lists. And you ask why, okay? Because there are different emphasis. Matthew, as we know, we mentioned in the last, 2 weeks ago, and then also Pastor David in the Walk Through the Bible mentioned it to the people that different gospel writers write to different audiences. So Matthew was writing for the Jews, so he was very concerned about focusing on Jesus as the Messiah, the promised one. Luke, however, was writing to non-Jews, people like us, the Gentiles, outsiders who have no clue as to what's going on in terms of the Jewish side. Okay, so because of that, the focus is different. And if you look carefully, the Matthew part traces to Abraham, the father of the Jewish nation. And Luke traces back to Adam. Okay, now there's a reason. Because Matthew is talking about this God's covenant through Abraham to the Jewish people. God's covenant with Abraham and the Jewish people, because Matthew was focusing on the Jews, okay, as the people who are waiting for the Messiah. Luke, however, focuses on Jesus as one of us, the human. So Jesus, the son of Adam, the son of God. Okay, so we have the reason for that. Then again, you notice something. There are two different ancestors. I didn't realize until I read the list. You notice the lists were quite different. The names were quite different. Some names were the same, but some names were not the same. Now, King David didn't have only one son, Solomon. In fact, he had about 20 sons. Okay, and the list from Matthew is through Solomon. Solomon, the son of David. Whereas in Luke, it was through Nathan. Now, we're not talking about Nathan the prophet, although he might be named after Nathan the prophet who ministered to David. He's called Nathan, okay? Now, we never knew that David had a son called Nathan. Now, he had one, okay? So that's a different list. And scholars have said that Matthew was talking about Joseph's side of the family, whereas Luke was talking about Mary's side of the family, which is interesting. And Joseph is supposed to be, if you read that list, it says Joseph of Heli. Okay, so you say, but how come if it's Mary's line, Joseph is of Heli? But then if you look carefully, the Greek version is quite different, after I mentioned it. So you have Matthew's list and Luke's list. So Luke's list, I am not pushing it all the way to Adam. I'm just looking from Abraham downwards. There are some commonalities, but then there are all the different names already, the maternal line, very different names, but then there's intermarriage. You know from your own family, there's also Miswa relationship, right? Noodle relationship, where you find that, oh, I've got a relative here, I've got a relative there, I've got a cousin there. And then, yeah, Chinese New Year, very good. Can go and ask for ang pao. But you know, I mean, you find that you've got relatives in between that you didn't know about. So there's intermarriage in this particular situation. There's something that was going on there. We'll come back to it. But if you look at the list, Joseph, if you look at the Greek part, it says, like, for example, Levi is the son of Melchi, Matat is the son of Levi, Heli is the son of Matat. But when it comes to Joseph, the Greek word doesn't say that Joseph is the son of. It says Joseph of Heli. Now, what it means could be, he could be the nephew of Heli, he could be the son-in-law of Heli or whatever. That means he's of the household of Heli. So that begins to, I think you'll be very interested, because it means that there's something going on there. Joseph is somehow linked to Heli, but he is not the physical son of Heli. Okay? Now, let's go on to the next part. We answer a few questions first before we look into the juicy side. Why are the fathers' names different? If you look at the list carefully, you will find that Jeconiah, sometimes known as Jehoiakim or Coniah, is the father of Salathiel, okay, according to Matthew. But then Luke says the father of Salathiel is a guy called Neri. Now, you find the list don't quite follow, okay? Now, scholars have struggled with all these issues, but I'm giving you the simple version. Now, in the Jewish history in the past, they have what we call the Levirate marriage. Okay, so let's just see this example. Let's say there's a man named Tom. He has two sons, John and Jake. John is married, okay, he's got one son, but Jake is also married, but no sons. Okay, now what happens if Jake dies? A Levirate marriage is John will have to marry Jake's wife as his second wife, okay? And let's say John takes widow of Jake and marries her and has a son called Victor. Now, Victor would be considered Jake's son, not John's son. The reason for the Levirate marriage is so that no family will be without, you know, inheritance down the line. Okay, they want to be sure that everybody has a line going down the centuries, as it were. So some records might show John, the father of Victor, because he's the biological father. But then some might say Jake, the father of Victor, because he's the legal father now. You get what I mean? Okay, so keep that in mind. So when you say father of, it could mean that, okay? Then it could also mean son of means of the household of. So you can be a brother or a nephew or a cousin. You are the son of the household. Generic name. Or the third one could mean when you say so-and-so begets so-and-so, they could skip a few generations because you can be the grandfather of so-and-so. So you don't have to be the father of so-and-so. For example, in this list, you will find a whole list of names missing where the arrow shows you have names like Ahaziah, Athaliah, Joash, and Amaziah. The whole list is missing. And it says Joram, the father of Uzziah. Or rather, beget Uzziah. You say, how can he be the father of? Actually, he's the great-great-grandfather of. It goes down the list. So it does skip like that, okay? So not to worry. That helps you to understand. Now, okay, let's go back to the list. You have Joseph's family line and Mary's family line, okay? Now, keep that in mind. There's also something in the Bible that talks about a promise and a curse. Now, we are quite familiar with the promise of God to David that says your house and kingdom will endure forever, okay? And your throne will be established forever, okay? So God has made this promise to David already. But then what happens? There's also a curse. I didn't realize until I started researching this, you know. A curse on Jehoiakim, one of the descendants of David. Sometimes it's known as Coniah, sometimes it's Jeconiah. Okay, Jeremiah the prophet says of him, he says, none will sit on the throne of David or rule anymore in Judah. That means your family is cursed. Nobody will come from your line to sit on the throne of David. Now, if you look at the house of David, Jalat, man, you know, from Joseph's line, when you come to Jeconiah, from then onwards, it means tabule jalan already, cannot already. Okay, but Mary's line is okay. So the promise has to move from Joseph's line to Mary's line, but how do you do that? Okay, keep that in mind. Let me just pause and mention something. Some of you might be from Roman Catholic background or know about Roman Catholics, and Roman Catholic says the parents of, or the father of Mary is actually named Joachim. And then we look at it and it says Heli in the Bible. Joachim is a variant form of Elakim, which is also a variant of Heli. So it's the same name. So your people didn't teach you the wrong thing, okay? Joachim is also Heli, same, okay? Now we go back to the whole issue. Mary's family tree. Now if you look at Mary's family tree, Joseph could be the son-in-law. Remember, he is of Heli. He's not necessarily son of Heli, okay? So he is the son-in-law. Now, this is the very interesting part. In the Old Testament, only sons can inherit. So like if you sing Be Thou My Vision, the last time when it comes to the part that says, and I thy true son, I refuse to sing. It's because I'm not a son, right? So how can I sing and I thy true son, right? Until somebody told me, actually what it means is this. In the Bible, sons inherit. So you're I thy true inheritor. So when you talk about son, you are the inheritor. Okay. But then there is a little interesting situation in Numbers 27. There was a family, the daughters of Zarephath, and the father had no sons, only the daughters. And so the daughters went to Moses and said, hey, you know, our father died without a son. So who should inherit? Can we inherit? So Moses sought the Lord, and the Lord says, yes, the daughters can inherit. No sons, they inherit. So inheritance of the family name, all that can go through the daughter as long as they marry within their tribe. Okay? Now, that's the interesting thing. The scholars said that Heli, Mary's father, could have died without a son. And Mary married Joseph, who is also from the same tribe of Judah, and so he came into Mary's line as the inheritor of Mary's line. So what you see is David's royal bloodline did go to Jesus. The promise was given, right? That somebody from David's line will become king forever. It did go through Jesus to Jesus, but from Mary's side of the family, through Nathan, the son of David, minus the curse line, because it went from Joseph's side, jump over to Mary's side, because he's the son-in-law, and he married the inheritor, so he inherits as well. So that's one way in which God did it. But the other way is Mary's birth of Jesus' birth was virgin birth. So Joseph was not the biological father, he was the legal father, but not the biological father. Although in the Bible it will say, you know, Jesus himself began his ministry, and that's the bracket. Being as it was supposed, the son of Joseph, but in reality, he's not biologically. So God bypassed it. God blessed Joseph, the family of David, but he bypassed the curse. That's a very interesting thing. I never knew it existed until I did the research. So let me just run through, because it went pretty fast, very academic. Okay, why two different lists? Two different emphasis, okay? Matthew on one list, Luke on the other, different emphasis. Two different ancestors from King David. Matthew, Joseph's line from Solomon. Luke from Mary's line from Nathan. Why father's name missing? Because it could be a Levirate marriage where they take the uncle's name and the father's name, so you get two different names. Or it can be from the household of, or beget, meaning missing a few generations, jump down, also still from the family. Okay? Then we talked about the promise and the curse. There's the promise, there's a curse. And how did God solve it? Okay, through Mary's side of the family. Or it could be both, the virgin birth. Okay, now you say very interesting, this academic thing. What does it say to us today? What relevance? First is that God fulfills his promise, even if it takes a long time. And a lot of times God isn't able to fulfill his promise to us because we are rebellious. And so, you know, it's like somebody wants to give you a gift and your hand is close, close, close. So until you open your hand, you can't receive anything, or your hand holding something else. So basically, what God needs to do is to prepare us to receive the gift. And if you look carefully in the history of Israel, after King David, Solomon, the kingdom divided into two. So 10 tribes stayed up north, the kingdom of Israel under a rebel called Jeroboam. And then the southern kingdom had only two tribes under Rehoboam, the son of Solomon. And they kept rebelling against God. God sends prophets, they kept turning against him. In the last few months, I've been listening to some CDs, dramatic readings of the Bible, which I found among my father's things. So I started listening to it as I drove the car. And when we hit 1 Kings, 2 Kings, 1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, you hear the whole history of the kings of Israel. And it's like, you know, they don't know when to repent, you know. Every time they do something wrong, God corrects them, they go back to it again. So you got good kings, bad kings. Okay, so you see the thumbs up, thumbs down. But then also you will see that some of the kings might be thumbs up, like Joash, okay? He's four from the bottom on your left side, okay? Joash started as a good king. He was brought up by one of the priests. But then when his mentor died, he turned bad. Then you've got somebody who is Manasseh, the third from the top on the right-hand side. Manasseh was a nasty fella. But then after he got really walloped and all that, he turned back to the Lord. So, you know, you get pros and cons, but, you know, God can't really bless the nation when it's like up, down, seasick kind of thing. And then when the people really didn't obey God, the northern kingdom was destroyed by the Assyrians. The southern kingdom, which had only two tribes, was taken, and Jerusalem was destroyed by the Babylonians. Babylonians took the people into captivity. And then when the Persians defeated the Babylonians, they were allowed to come back to rebuild Jerusalem. So you have Ezra and Nehemiah. And after the Persians, the Greeks defeated the Persians. So the Greeks took over and tried to conquer the people of Israel and bully them. But then the Jews revolted against the Greeks and were quite successful. You can read it in the book of Maccabees, which is in the Roman Catholic Bible in between the Old and New Testament. But then after that, the Romans came in, defeated the Greeks. And so, you know, ikan bilis that swallowed by kimbap law got swallowed by a bigger fish as well. You know, you get the barracuda. And then so the Romans, like the barracuda, ate all. And so they came under the Romans. And all this period, God was inviting his people to come back. But they refused. And so they kept saying, you know, God, have you forgotten us? When are you going to deliver us from the oppression? You've promised. When will the Messiah come? As we know, at Christmas time, we said, you know, very silently, God sent his Messiah. And in the hymn, O Little Town of Bethlehem, it says, the wondrous gift is given in a very quiet way in Bethlehem. God keeps his promises, even though it takes a long time. And for us, some of us might be struggling with, you know, the spouse. When is my spouse going to change? When is my child going to do the right thing? The child has turned away prodigal. How? Job, finance, the healing that we seek. When, Lord, when? Reconciliation, conversion of a loved one or transformation of somebody's life or situation. When, Lord, will you answer? And one of the songs that perhaps we will probably sing afterwards is very interesting. This song was in my mind when I was going to study in the States, and it was something that formed me in some ways. And it says, I must wait on the Lord and learn my lessons well. In his timing, he will tell me what to do, where to go, what to say. I learn my lessons well. If we don't learn the lesson, we can't move to the next step. We won't be able to move there, even if God wants to give it to us. It's like primary school kid, primary five. You can't go to primary six if you don't know your lessons, right? It's not because the teachers are nasty or anything, or the system is bad. But if we haven't learned it, you can't go to the next step. And sometimes, because of our stubbornness, we are stuck. We sing, in his time. He makes all things beautiful in his time. You do just what you say, but in his time, Lord. He will do it, but we need to be able to change. God always fulfills his promises, even if it's impossible by human terms. I mean, you saw how the whole thing worked between the promise and the curse. You know, I mean, it was like a detective story when I did this research. I mean, I had to go through all the kings and try to figure out the thing, and it's like, gosh, you know, I mean, God really sneaked from the back door in twice. It's like, wow, you know, but God will do that. If you look at the story of this guy, this was an ex-prisoner. When he was in prison, he was a drug addict. His parents came to visit him and cried, and he said, yeah, I will change. I will change. At 1 o'clock, when he was released, 3 o'clock, he started taking drugs again. I mean, you know, like that, where got hope? And then he was allowed to get married when he was in prison. So he went to get married. But for the wedding ceremony, he told his friends, bring drugs over so he can smuggle it in. I mean, this kind of guy, where got hope? And today, the guy is Reverend Don Wong. He preached here some time ago. He's one of the chaplains in prison. Can you imagine God transforming somebody like that? He's the founder of New Charis Mission. God can do it. God can do something impossible if we let him. The second is that God gives significance. Sometimes some of us might be struggling for significance. You know, I want to make an impact. I want to leave a legacy, blah, blah, blah. But then you feel that you are nobody. People don't bother about you, or you are too far gone. How can you be a blessing? Now imagine this guy saying, my younger brother is a king. I'm the forgotten one. Nobody even remembers me. Somebody else was chosen. I'm always the one not favored. Who could he be? He could be Nathan, the brother of King Solomon. If you look at the list, David had 20 children, okay? He had wives and concubines. And he married Bathsheba. The first child was died, right? You know the story. The second one, the third one, and the fourth one. The third one is Nathan. Maybe named after Prophet Nathan, but he's the one we don't know very much about. But who do we know? We know Solomon. And his younger brother became king. His younger brother was favored. He wasn't. I mean, how did he feel? But yet God honored him. The Messiah came through his line, not through Solomon's line. Then you have the unknowns. If you look at the list, I mean, amazed. I mean, you want to find names for your kids. Yeah, whole bunch of them you don't know. The ones in blue, you don't know who on earth they are. You see, whole list, the two lists, you don't know who they are in that list. But yet God used them for the Messiah's line. Then you have the sinners in the list. Abraham and Isaac, we all Sunday school, everything very sweet. And all these people are heroes, actually. They're not, if you read now, very juicy stories about them. Abraham and Isaac, you know, they like to protect their own lives, but not their wives' lives. Quite nasty people in that sense. Jacob stole his brother's birthright. Judah and his brother sold his brother Joseph to slavery and then lied to their father. Then you've got murderers. This guy Lamech who says, you know, I will, anybody hit me once, I will hit them a few times. You know, I mean, his way of speaking. David committed adultery and then killed Uriah, or had Uriah killed. And then you got the immoral ones. Bathsheba was committing adultery. Rahab was involved in prostitution. Tamar was involved in incest. I mean, you get all that funny group of people, all imperfect, insignificant people. And it's amazing grace that God would use them to bring forth his Messiah. It's grace upon grace. No wonder Mary in the song in Luke chapter 1 says, he has cast down the mighty from their thrones and exalted the lowly. God is like that. He does things beyond our imagination. It's grace upon grace. And in the words of Paul Tillich, a great theologian, which I think I quoted before, basically he says, stop striving. Just receive from the Lord. You are accepted. You are accepted. Do not seek for anything. Do not perform anything. Do not intend anything. Just accept the fact that you are accepted. And perhaps we just need that encounter with grace first before we do anything for the Lord. So that's the second thing. Stop striving. Just accept grace of God, that God will see us and do something from our lives if we are willing to let him, even if we are not known to anybody in the future or in the past. Now, if you look carefully in the Bible, you will find a whole list of names. It's like the Bible is obsessed with names and lists. 1 Kings, 2 Kings, Chronicles, and all that. And Nehemiah even mentioned how many people, who were they who came back with him from the foreign land to go and build the ruined Jerusalem. So it's like, why bother? So many names, you know nothing about these people, but you just list names after names. Well, what we discover is roots are important to God. How I'm connected to others from the past and the present are important in the Bible. We always think, you know, all this miso kind of relationship, this noodle relationship, not important. You know, we tend to ask questions, especially young people, who am I? What's the real me? What's my destiny? And some would say, what legacy do I leave behind? You notice it's all about me. It's about me and I. Maybe we ought to ask another question. If roots are important to God, the question that we ask is, to whom do I belong? Which spiritual household do I come from? Who's the Lord of that household and what's the calling of that family? Because when we look at that and ask the questions like that, we have a sense of rootedness, that loneliness is not there anymore. There's a sense of responsibility and identity. Responsibility to the family, identity in terms of my calling in life. Jesus would say, I belong to, if you looked at the Matthew list, the royal house of David. So God has a covenant with me. I am secure. And then if he looks at the Luke line, Adam, he's related to Adam with this long list. My responsibility is care for God's creation. God is Lord, and I am blessed to be a blessing. So maybe when we ask the question, to whom do I belong? Which spiritual household do I come from? You come from a family. What is that spiritual, if your family is Christian, what is the spiritual gift of that family? You know, sometimes, whether it's your church, your cell, denomination, there's a uniqueness about it. Do some history. You know, an archives is not dead. History is not dead. God works in history. God is a God of history. And there's something in your root that God is speaking to you about your destiny and your calling and your children's destiny and their calling. I mean, I look at my family and I can trace about 30 pastors from different sides of the family and me, Sumawan. Kind of scary, huh? But then some of you look at your family and you say, wow, my family, a whole bunch of doctors. Or my family, a whole bunch of engineers. Even a church family, like this church, I throw a stone, I hit five teachers. So we've got a calling in teaching here. You go down the road to Living Waters Methodist Church, you throw a stone, you hit five doctors. So they've got a calling there also. You go to some churches, especially the mega churches, and all that, you throw a stone, you hit 15 salesmen or businessmen. Each one has a DNA. What is your calling? If you look at your family or your cell or your denomination and church, there is something in the inheritance that God wants to give us. Then the other thing is when you ask the question, who's the Lord of the household? Household of your cell, of your church, and so on. This is not an example for you to judge, you know, oh, you know, bad, bad, we are not putting the Lord as Lord. But looking at our lives and say, hey, how do I make him Lord in my life, of my destiny and my children's destiny, and also of my church, if he is not put as Lord? And then the question of the calling of that family, or of the cell, of the church or denomination. Like Israel, their flag has the Star of David that speaks about God's promise that they will be a blessing to the nations. Salvation Army, their theme is blood and fire, the blood of Christ, fire of the Holy Ghost. And so they go out in that kind of emphasis. Then you've got the 12 tribes of Israel. Each one has a logo, as it were, to emphasize what their special calling is. What about yours? In your bulletin, you will find the notes of this message and also the questions. I'd like you to go back and maybe talk to somebody that you know, your family member or your friend or church member, and ask these questions and try to explore it together. And then when you have discovered it, live it out, because that's your calling and your destiny. Let us pray. Father, we thank you that you are a God of history. Very often, Lord, we don't bother about history and we think it's not important. But you see it as important because you are the God of generations. Generations before us and the generations after us. And you've done miracles and you keep your promises. So we thank you for this lesson from the Bible about the genealogy of Jesus and what it means for our lives. So Lord, would you help us to be able to see with your eyes your special calling for us in our families, in the family of the church, in ourselves, in our denomination, that we might live out that which you have called us. It doesn't matter if our names are not known. It doesn't matter if we are the forgotten ones. But you will not forget us, and you will honor your promise to us that you will never leave us nor forsake us, and that you will bless us even as we walk your way. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you